Hello, everybody. Welcome back. It's the grand finals of the North American Qualifier Complexity. Facing up against Digital Chaos, I have myself as well as Blitz Dota going to be leading you through the rocky waters that has been the North American Qualifier so far. And our draft for game number one is already here. Blitz, you got the opportunity to cast Complexity in their matchup against FDL. How did they look?
They were pretty good. Like, they had some shaky moments and things weren't great at certain parts, but they dispatched of a team that isn't bad. And this is kind of the finals that we anticipated anyways, though.
Yeah. I mean, that's got to be a little bit. I'm more concerned hearing that. That wasn't bad. There were shaky moments. That is concerning for me because they're facing up against a team that they obviously lost to not so long ago today. So that is a bit concerning for me, but I guess we'll see how it unfolds.
I think DC, at the same time, it is concerning mainly because I think DC is a very good team. I think this team at Manila, this was a team that Liquid was even looking at and was surprised at. And I think this is a team that is going to surprise some people. Like, I know they got top 12, but I think they have the potential for more.
Yeah, they were. They started off in the upper bracket and they lost. Did they lose two games in a row once they managed to the main?
It was either 2-0 by Newbie.
Yeah.
Which is, one of the games was winnable, though. Then they got 2-1 by VGR.
Yeah. So they started off the actual main event in a good position to place much higher. But fortunately, two rough series is all it takes to knock you out of that double elimination. We are going to be starting off this very first game of the best of five with an Elder Titan first pick. We're going to follow that up Beastmaster and Invoker for Digital Chaos, both cores being picked up there, while Complexity actually going for both their supports in the form of now an Oracle to couple with that Elder Titan.
Yeah, I still don't know how I feel about Oracle as a hero. I know that in NA scene especially, the hero is favored pretty high. But I think overall, like, I still kind of feel like the hero is sort of so placed. I remember I said that in a cast with you, and I think it was like FDL that picked it. And they kind of made it work, though.
Sorry, go ahead.
I was just saying, I think that the hero still might be a little bit too small, but
yeah. It's kind of interesting that they... I'm not sure how you feel about the combination of Elder Titan Oracle either, because while you can see it sounds good maybe in paper against a solo offlaner, you're able to get the ensnare of Fortune's End directed into a free stomp for the Elder Titan, but that is a combo by itself that is only going to happen every once in a while, and these are two supports that feels like very chaotic fights. They can be not enough. They're not very reliable, I would say, the two of them.
Yeah, I agree.
So it feels kind of awkward having both of them on the same team. But hey, it's something we've seen in North American qualifiers before, and it's worked before. So I guess we'll have to see how it fares for Complexity. Our next round of bans, we got the Clinks as well as Lone Druid taking away big physical damage dealers on both sides. Pushing style heroes, I guess, to couple with the Beastmaster. Digital Chaos, knowing the Complexity, have a good saving hero in the Oracle, or will ban away the Death Prophet. And they can't really have the Batrider in their own hands, and Complexity still need a nice initiator, so they'll take that one out of the pool as well.
All right, let's see. Invoker, Beastmaster, strong setup. What does Cole need then? What do they even take? What do you take, like Void offlane or something? Does Swindles even play Void?
I mean, I'm sure he can pick up Iron Talon and it'll all be good, but Dragonite. I mean, you definitely needed some pushing style hero. Death Prophet obviously would have been their best option. They still get the DK push mid. 10 seconds remaining. I don't know. I just like Digital Chaos's opening a whole lot more. 5 seconds remaining.
I think that the opening's just solid. It's not. It's only two picks in, so it's hard to comment too much on it. But yeah, it's not bad.
It feels more reliable to have Beastmaster, who could do so many things off lane. He can forward position if they want to. He can do some jungling straight away. He's one of the fastest junglers in the game. And then Invoker, who's just been one of the more, I think, at least, reliable cores, just because he's relatively impactful early on. He can usually win his lane, or at least do all right. And he obviously scales really well into late game, probably better than almost any other mid laner we see right now. Outside of maybe a Phantom Lancer or something. But obviously, Complexity are going to be running the DK mid here against the Invoker. That's not a terrible matchup, right? DK just gets what he needs out of the lane, nothing more.
Yeah. DK does okay, just because the high armor makes it so that it's very hard for heroes to kind of mess with you.
Mm-hmm. Winter Wyvern now for Digital Chaos. Feels like the... Venomancer. Okay, that's definitely an aggressive style, pushing core, starts the tempo rather early on. Venomancer core, so Venomancer safe lane? I mean, usually we see Venomancers mid, but they already have a Dragonite. This is a safe lane farming DK? 10 seconds remaining. What's going on here, Blitz?
I don't know, you could even do Veno off. This is kind of just a weird situation. Like, I don't know why you would take this Veno this early on.
Yeah.
Because it's not going to get banned, so it must just be something that they have in mind. More than anything.
Yeah,
but
they must have some.
Slark's going to be the follow-up. Slark doesn't deathpack the ulti, but he deathpacks the Poison Nova, right? Or the Venomous Gale.
Yeah, the Gale. The Gale, but
yeah,
not the ult.
Not the Poison Nova, yeah. Yeah.
But nothing the, takes that but off. The ult's kind of offset by the fact that you could just go off map, right? Complexity don't see you, you start getting the regen kicking in from your ult, and that pretty much offsets the damage over time of Venomancer, so.
Dude, this looks like a 6 Slark game. There's like one disable for you.
Yeah, and it's really, really easily telegraphed, the Elder Titan stomp, and then...
I was talking about the DK
stun. Yeah, the DK stun. Yeah. But
what, then Shadowblade or Blink Dagger DK is absolutely necessary?
Yeah. 5 seconds remaining. Complexity definitely have to hit this lineup really hard, really early. They're going to ban away the Phoenix. Pretty understandable. That's just a good teamfight hero that Complexity would have a hard time fighting into. I think teamfight is really all that DC need to ensure victory here, because they very clearly have the scaling necessary. All they have to do is stop Complexity's high ground push. There is a lot more on the checklist of things to do for Complexity in this game number one. They still need an offlaner of some sort. We suggested, Faceless Void earlier. It could still be a good initiator, considering they have two somewhat ranged cores. They actually ban away the Lifestealer. Do you think this is like Veno offlane?
Yeah. I think that's what I assumed instantly, right? I said Veno offlane seems kind of okay, but maybe you even go aggro. I don't... You can do like some kind of like Veno ET weirdness and go Oracle in a safe laner.
Yeah, that works. I like that idea, actually. So in which case, if you still have a safe lane carry, you most likely can't outscale an Invoker, Slark, Beastmaster, Winter Wyvern. So you gotta get a pushing style hero. What's left? Lycan? Any other good temple controllers? Lifesteal was banned away, I guess. That was probably their best option. What's really good versus Slark?
Nothing?
Lifestealer
was good.
Unbeatable hero.
Wait, is Timber banned? Just 5 seconds
remaining. Just pick Timber, up a safe guys. Lane, Timber. Yeah. Then you have very little high ground push outside of your TK.
Don't
you want
fine.
More of that?
You just kill heroes in Dota. High ground's not a thing.
What about Sven?
You just kill heroes. Sven's not a good high grounder. You just kill heroes. Sven's not bad, though. But you don't... Before, in the past, like, you would need a dedicated high ground hero, but you already have that. Like, you have one. You have DK. That's all you really need. The rest of the time, you're just going to kill people. So...
You only need one. Okay.
Yeah. It's like Highlander, man.
There can only be
one. The high ground hero killed everybody else.
Oh, okay. Well, 25 more seconds. Complexity All right, you better start getting your predictions on point here, buddy. I don't want to see any more loss of battle points.
Wait, you tweeted that it was a rivalry?
Whatever.
I don't think Complexity have beaten Digital Chaos yet.
Well, you know, who would you rather have? As a North, would you rather have Complexity versus FTL be the rivalry? DC versus EG?
I mean, FTL did beat Complexity once, so that kind of sounds a little bit more reasonable to me, to be honest with you.
Wow, you're going into this series with real high hopes for Cole.
Dude, I want...
Cole is one win away from taking first.
That was the crazy part. And FTL stopped them.
And they lost it. They didn't take first because they're lost to FTL.
That is maybe the funniest thing about this entire situation. Like, if FTL is the reason why Complexity doesn't... Like, if, let's
get
say,
the guarantee
let's just say in a hypothetical world that Complexity loses series, and it all comes down to that butterfly effect moment. 5 seconds remaining.
You're getting way too much of a kick out of this. You're evil.
Dude, I like the guys on Complexity a lot.
I know you do.
So, this is me just... As a commentator, though, it's pretty funny.
It's a funny storyline. It's a pretty funny narrative, indeed.
Yeah.
All right,
these guys don't really care. They just like showed up and beat them.
Complexity have chosen to go for the last pick, Gyrocopter for Chessie. Blitz Dota, while we're watching the wards being laid down and everything else, we have 1 minute to decide our predictions.
All right, hit me up, fam.
Player with the highest total magic or pure damage done to heroes by 25 minutes. That's gotta be the gyro, right?
Huh?
That's gotta be the gyro, right?
I don't know, man. I feel like Rubik can throw out a lot of fade bolts. No, I think it'll be gyro. Team with the most Roshan kills.
Yes.
DC.
Yeah, you're going DC?
Yeah, okay. Easily. There's like no Roshiros on Complexity, dude. They actually
they're the more aggressive team. They're dire side. Even if they can't take it very quickly.
Yeah, we'll take it. Not taking it very quickly is an understatement.
All right. First player to get 15 denies. Last series, the very last game, the answer was nobody. So
really? Nobody got 15?
Nobody got 15 denies.
Is that an answer?
In Cole versus FDL. No,
let's
that is not an answer. You have to choose
a
player.
Let's take
we. All right. And total number of smoke gang kills at game end. Oh, we missed it. All right. Well, you can. I actually
spiritual
don't
answer. I'll say two.
Two smoke gank kills.
All right. Or like you smoke and then you get a kill.
Yeah.
Or like
you
it,
get
what
you,
get
you smoke fight? Up your smoke pops and within 10 seconds you get into an engagement that results in a kill.
Okay. What if you get like four kills? Does that count as four? I don't even care about that category.
All
it's
right,
still
all
pointless.
Right, all right. Fine. Fine. Real quickly, can you check in your Dota TV? Can you lower the threshold? Apparently, you're cutting off a little bit in game.
Okay, sure.
All right, so we are going to be starting off with dual lane, Z-Freak versus Soxa on the two opposing supports, Weeha on the Invoker and Limp on the Dragonite as our opposing cores. They're going to be trying to mess with each other as much as possible because, well, they've got nothing else to do. After all, both offlaners are going to be full-time jungling. Don't think a Venomancer beats a Beastmaster, but it's probably going to be pretty close. This has kind of already been theory crafted that Venomancer, now with the change-up of damage, is able to do a lot more with his wards. We'll see what Swindles... I mean, this is the first time I've seen it.
I told you about that, right?
Yeah.
We talked about that at a tournament. Let's keep it vague. About the possibility of a Veno jungle.
I think actually it was maybe me, you, and Purge had this conversation about veggies.
No, because I knew about this beforehand.
Okay, fair enough.
It had been experimented with to disastrous results.
Disastrous results? Well, we'll see if Swindles is able to.
But it got buffed. It got buffed.
Yeah. Provide the bit more oomph to it with the Iron Talon pickup, and is already level 3 by 2 minutes. That is ahead of Moose Beastmaster so far. It's just now picking up his level 3.
Hey, this is pretty quick, because you can do two camps at once.
Yeah.
Swindles. What a player.
Breaking the meta. He's now moving his way over to the hard camp instead of the medium camp, the left-hand side, now that he's got his upgraded wards.
Dude, this is my favorite thing to watch ever. Like I haven't even looked at another lane since it started.
You don't even care? I mean, the other lanes are pretty boring. You could just check out mid and see where the CS is going, and that's pretty much all you need to know.
Too. Like, it's not anything's happening. He's just farming the same camp.
No, no one's killing the Dragonite, and Dragonite's certainly not killing the Invoker, so...
Yeah. This is like a National Geographic, man. Junglers in the wild. It is... I don't know how to feel about that, by the way. In terms of how Dota's kind of shifted away from having an offlane and just having some guy, you know, farm nonstop.
You can say it's awful.
Mm.
I'll let you. Z-Freak, potentially first blood. The sun strikes in the line first. Oh, just moments before the TP completes. Sad Z-Freak thought. Yeah, he got the, you know, the support syndrome where you're running around the map and the lanes aren't really set up for you to do anything. So you try and push a little hard to do something. He goes into the offlane and immediately gets caught.
It's okay, though, because this Venomancer is level 6 almost at 4 minutes.
Yeah, and... what? He's almost level...
Dude,
Jesus!
He's going to get it at 3 minutes and 40 seconds.
Holy crap. And he's still got Ancients to farm, too, by the way. Like, Z-Freak should have been stacking this up a little bit more. So
yeah,
I think
3-minute, 40-second Venomancer level 6, that is... ungodly. That's a full level ahead of that Invoker that got a kill. Home.
Yeah. Insane. Insane stuff. Haestrin gonna be picked up, or denied rather, by Soxa.
Wonder what Resolution decides to go for. If he decides to go for just like Blink. Blink looks pretty good this game. Shadow Blade is an option, but at the same time, if Cole decide to 5-man, the effectiveness of the item gets kind of limited a little bit more.
What is it for you that determines the difference between Blink and Shadow Blade for Slark?
I think Shadow Blade is a better pickoff and split push item, and I think Blink is a better teamfight item. Mm-hmm.
So in this kind of scenario, say you're able to jump in and put pressure on the Venomancer really early on. You can force him to use his ult early without the rest of your team engaging.
The downside, though, about Blink... Okay, so... You hit the hammer on the nail or whatever. If you pick Slark and you try to go Shadow Blade against a 5-man lineup and they just play sentries everywhere, you're gonna have to use your ultimate to initiate. Oh, right. Beastmaster gets a kill on that DK.
Yep.
Mu just pops out of the jungle. That's convenient, but like we were talking about. Oh, at bottom, Swindles is.
Is he dead? Maybe. I'm kind of following top at the same time. Mu, he's getting away. Swindles, Sunstrike. Ooh. All right, Sweetheart.
Man, he almost won that fight.
Lands another one.
He could have won that fight.
Yeah.
He was going to win that fight.
If he didn't man down?
Yeah, there was no... Slark has no mana to use Dark or Shadow Dance.
Yeah.
He just got enough because over time, but before that point, he wouldn't have had it, even if he tread swapped. That's crazy.
Yeah. And considering how incredibly overleveled he is... That is rather unfortunate that he dies to the Slark. Gives away a lot of experience.
Oh, that's a level 7 Venomancer.
Yeah, I thought he was just going to go from doing his neutrals to doing the Ancients, because he's got maxed out wards now. So I figured you would never put yourself in danger of being caught twice in a row, Swindles. You don't have a TP here, my friend. This pounce is your death. He's going to try and juke his way through the trees, has lots of wards down. He's going to be playing around this. He's fully committed at this point, and he wants to be able to see if he can get some sort of turnaround kill. In fact, he's going to survive as his allies come in, and both are incredibly low. They're going to be able to get the last hit from the Oracle onto one. Resolution tries to scoot his way through the trees. Nice juke out, but Hanskin's going to be able to scout him. Doesn't have the mana for the nuke, but Z-Freak is here to save the day. Swindles not only survives, but they manage to get the kill on both of the DC members trying to take him out.
Yeah, this Slark hates this Venomancer right now. Because you can't do anything. He can't immediately burst him down. The Venomancer wards do too much damage. He's so over-leveled right now. Like, this is a level 8 Venomancer with an Aquila. What are you going to do against that? That's a higher level than the Gyrocopter. That's almost as much farm as the Gyro right now. Like, in terms of net worth, this Venomancer... is just below the Beastmaster, who has a kill of his own.
It's always fun to cast complexity games when they're on a elimination point in a tournament. Obviously, this isn't full elimination. They would just go into the wild card, but they would much rather have the secured invite into TI directly without having to worry about that wild card series. Last time we saw, what was it, the Axe Winter Wyvern combination that they pulled out? Where
that was at Epicenter?
Double jungling, yep. That was Epicenter versus EG, I think?
Fnatic.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Roar on to Hanskin. Sunstrike over the top. Hanskin won't be able to save himself from that one. Misery. Now the question is, can he actually save Mu? Mu will be able to dance himself to the side here, dodging Chessie's ultimate. And Mu is going to be cut off potentially by Limp. He drives himself deeper into the jungle, goes for the TP out, and will be successful. That's going to be four members of Complexity all wasting their time for a kill. That didn't happen.
Yeah. And the biggest issue right now for Cole is that this Weeha Invoker has Midas now, and I'm going to tell you something. When you play against an Invoker, you feel uncomfortable. Like, this must have happened to everybody at least once in chat, right? You're playing against an Invoker, you leave him alone, he gets one or two Sunstrike kills, and all the time you're thinking, this guy has Midas and he's farming.
Yeah.
He puts that, like, psychological pressure on you. Because you know this guy's just going to scale like crazy and be annoying. And it's a Weeha Invoker. Like, this is one of the best Invokers in the world.
Right.
I can feel comfortable saying that because of his performance at big stages with this hero.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got those two factors in mind. A, he's got a really fast Midas. B, you know, it's a Weeha Invoker. And now Complexity, you're probably thinking, like, we should get things accomplished sooner than later.
TP out. Misery, he'll be fine. Mu may still be cut off here. Hanskin and Limp are going to make their way around. Mu didn't expect that one. And he realizes, to his dismay, that there's no way out of this one. Gets the roar off on Chessie with a Sunstrike, but Limp knows what was coming. Yeah, they all surrounded Chessie, realized that Hanskin's accidental, I believe, purifying flames on Chessie brought him dangerously low to getting one shot by a Sunstrike.
Yeah, that was very good. Well done by... it was really well done by Complexity to stick together. They're also able to get the kill on Mu. And, I mean, now they're in an okay position overall. I think the only downside right now for DC is that they're going to lose a lot of these tier 1 towers early, and their bottom tower's getting gone on, but, like, time and time again, this Invoker's picked up so many kills now, almost as drums already on top of the Aquila and that Hand of Midas.
Yeah.
Like, this is just a little bit too efficient.
And if anything, out of all the cores, right, it's the Invoker that you're most scared of as Complexity, because Complexity is going to be the one trying to broach high ground, and Invoker is one of the toughest heroes to push high ground into when he starts getting those big levels, 16 with Ags, get level 22, etc. He just becomes such a monster of outputting magic damage that you can't really be stopped.
It's not even just that, but if you look at Complexity's lineup, this is not a lineup that wants to deal with split push at all. Like, there are certain lineups that are okay with it. Like, when you have a Nature's Prophet on your team or you have pickoff heroes, you're okay with having to counter push out lanes. But this is not the type of lineup that wants to spend that time to push out lanes.
Right.
Like, this is a lineup that effectively wants to apply pressure at all times. And this is the right move because Invoker, even though he seems scary, like, you think of his potential damage and it's very high. But early on, when he's only got that first or second level of Invoke, this 22-second cooldown cap, you're only going to be able to cast, like, two spells.
We're on Z3-go. He will be saved by Hanskin. Tanks that Sunstrike. Soxa is going to be caught here inside the trees. The Gyrocopter does throw out the ultimate just to protect them, but they can't actually save the Elder Titan. He ends up going down to the damage anyway. One for one in supports, but Complexity see their moment to keep on moving forward. They're going to slow down Misery slightly. Won't be able to catch anybody, though, and they are being seriously delayed in taking this Tier 1 tower. They're still going to try and do it. This time, they're going to be facing up against Misery's plague wards that he's stolen away from Swindles.
It's not a bad steal, just because he can keep everybody back. And like we talked about, Complexity want to be on the aggressive this game, and DC want to just buy time. Because DC understands that if their lineup just has a little bit of time cap, they're going to get so much further ahead.
Right.
Like, they've got this Slark just free farming. We're talking about this, like, Invoker who's had, like, free farm and no pressure. And this Slark, who's been pressured multiple times and even killed, and this Slark has more net worth, despite not having a Midas. Like, this game is rapidly becoming really scary for Complexity.
So Complexity need to start getting a better hold on things. They can't even necessarily win some of these team fights. DC are even trying to pressure Complexity now. They're going to take a Tier 1 tower in return, and Cole aren't actually going to be able to fight it, it seems like. They're going to be going in. Dragonform is about to be down. Swindles doesn't have enough mana for his ult plus Gale. Looks like the tier 1 tower will be able to stay alive for now, but one push where Complexity aren't in position to be able to defend, and Invoker will claim that.
I think execution is now almost entirely on Cole. They really have to execute to win this game. I just think this game is kind of difficult for them to win because they only have one catch hero, and that's really how you determine a lot of this, is how many heroes that you have that can simply catch, who should be able to get out of here. Yeah, they're not even going to get him. Do you see the difficulty? Like, this highlights my point better than anything so far in the game. They send three heroes, two cores, up there to try to deal with that Beastmaster, and they can't even catch him. If you're having that much trouble, and look, Chessie's going to go down too now. That's Resolution's first reveal of the Shadowblade. He picks up a core kill because he knows that the Gyrocopter is going to be greedy. You don't want to respond to that if you're Complexity. That sucks for you. Because now you're going to have to rotate cores up here. You see now Swindles is up here. He doesn't want to be up here. Weehaw's going to push out his jungle. He's going to push out the mid lane. Like, this is not a good position for Complexity to be in. I know it's only a 2-kill difference, but think about the overall game flow and the tempo.
Yeah, Complexity definitely need to be the ones controlling the tempo of this game. And right now, since they don't have the heroes to punish these kind of split push or attempts at ganks, they are allowing Digital Chaos to be able to run kind of rampant. I mean, Mu, he didn't even have much of a shot at killing the Gyrocopter the first go-around, but he was able to commit more than he really should have, just because he knows, like, it's only the Dragonite that's going to be able to stop him from getting the TP out. He is now going to be potentially caught by this Dragonite, but as I say that, he does a quick ring around the rosy and limp. Is slowed down to a crawl by this boar being repeatedly kited out.
Okay, so now you've every single time you have to flash that DK core. We talked about it. What is their one disable in this game? It's that DK. So much of this onus goes on to limp. Yep. This game, he's uncomfortable. Like, this is not a game you feel good as a Dragonite, because you know that Slark is just going to rush a Silver Edge after that Echo Saber. Nobody survives against Resolution right now. Like, he's going to get those pickoffs for free every single time.
Elder Tang gets caught in the bottom lane, taken out by Sunstrike. We're going to follow Soxa, who ends up going down, though. So both supports end up falling. That's unfortunate,
but
as you're kind of pointing out, Dragonite shows. As soon as Dragonite showed, Weehaw pushed top lane.
Yeah. It's not even just that. At the same time Dragonite shows mid, then the Slark decides to do whatever he wants in this game.
Yeah.
And that's what people should focus on in games of Dota, is how easy is it for one team to get a kill over another. Like, this Slark is, he's a monster right now. Yeah. Like, this guy's the boogeyman. He's just this terror on the force. You don't want to run into him, but at the same time, like, you have to split up and farm in a game where you're not going to go for a 5-man. Because I think the opportunity to go for the straight 5-man is too hard.
Yeah. Well, top 2 net worth. Complexity are lacking behind in gold and experience. They do have this ancient sack that they're claiming, but things are looking a bit bleak for them. They need to start amping things up here in the next 5 minutes, or it's going to look real bad if 25 minutes they still don't have some of these tier twos. Can they possibly take a Roshan? We made some jokes about that. They're obviously incredibly slow. What do you do as Complexity if you're getting kited around and there's attempts at pickoffs you can't really punish? How do you stop this bleeding?
I'm not sure, because Slark in a game like this, the other reason why he's so onage is because he can scout for your wards. And every single time he sees the DK, then he can traverse to the other side of the map. He knows if he's being spotted or not. He knows, like, how the map is being rotated. Like, look, he's just spotted out 3 different wards. Like, Misery knows that there's a ward right there. He's going to wait for the lane to push out. He can deward that at his leisure. Like, there's a lot of different opportunities for them. In Complexity, what they have to do at all times is they've got to keep these lanes pushed out. Look at how aggressively this top lane is being pushed out by this Beastmaster and Soxa. These guys don't have a care in the world. Because at the end of the day, it's a 2800 net worth Winter Wyvern. He doesn't really care.
Yeah.
And every single time, like, Complexity, they have to be committed to doing these. At some point, I think as soon as you grab an item on anybody, you just go for it. And we talked about how the DK immediately, you can't go Armlight this game. You have to go Blink or Shadowblade.
Well, his first reveal of the Shadowblade is going to be a lot more lackluster. It will get the kill on the Winter Wyvern, but as you just pointed out, it was a 2800, now only 2700 net worth Winter Wyvern. You don't really care about his death too much.
Yeah. Right now, XP-wise, almost 5k. net worth before that kill was about 4K. They're in really stunning shape right now. This Winter Wyvern, the reason why you kill him is he plays that Pylite die roll where you're on the opposite side of the map farming away from your Slark. That's really important that you're not occupying the same space as Chorus. Complexity, though, that's a really good pickoff for them, and I do like that they waited for that Shadowblade and they didn't get too panicky, because it only takes one or two moments where they panic and they just lose the game. So now this is where the siege starts, but at the same time, Misery with the stolen wards again, it just makes this annoying more than anything. And Limp's spotted right now.
Counter ward already laid out. They're actually going to start going onto Limp. Telekinesis, a little bit of Arctic Burn, nothing major. They're not actually trying to contest too much here unless they get a really good Winter's Curse. They're just buying a little bit of space for... that was actually kind of close. They're buying space for Resolution to take this tier 2, slowly but surely.
It's not even that slowly. He's done 1,100 damage to it. This Invoker continues to farm. And something about DC is that everybody is working in tandem right now. They move with purpose. Like, their cores are splitting up. Like, one core takes this side, the other core takes this side. Then they can just keep sandwiching their farm. Complexity, we should talk about them a little bit more. But honestly, I think their plays are a lot more limited than DC's. Like, DC has the movement and the heroes to make cool moves like this. Like, I know they're not getting kills, but this is still good, really good movement. That's why I'm talking about it so much. But for Complexity, they're kind of just in this weird, awkward moment cap where they want to get aggressive, but they can't.
Yeah. It all revolves around Dragonite, and you're kind of living on a hope and prayer that you find an important hero with this Shadowblade. You're able to successfully gank something like a Slark, because without the Shadowblade initiation, it is a damn near impossibility that you can kill this Slark. Not enough disables, not fast enough.
Yeah, just keep doing this over and over again. Everybody farms out, you don't really have a lot of opportunities to do anything. DC will continue to play this game where they wrap you around. Complexity look like they're going to go for the one objective. They start on this Roshan, which just looks awkward. Oh, they're actually just counter warding against each other.
Is there a next round of items? I mean, Complexity, they're not really moving too much. And you say they're not panicking. Okay. That's good not to panic, but are you just waiting for opportunities from Limp?
Honestly, I'm not really sure what to do in this position either.
Yeah.
Like, if there was a clear move, I would... I'm thinking about it right now, but... I just think this Slark and this Invoker are too hard to lock down. They always split up on the map. So if one of them dies, the other gets to farm. Like, Weeha already has an Axe, man.
No level 16. Just level 13 with an Axe by 20 minutes.
Casual.
They are going to go for the Roshan, but this starts becoming more
fast.
And more obvious because they're so slow at it, and they're going to take a whole entire tier 2 atop lane with nobody of Complexity responding, because they can't. Like, they have to have everyone surrounding that Roshan pit because they don't have the guaranteed team fight if they get caught here.
Resolution's going to take the high ground angle. Mu's going to just continue to push top. He doesn't even really care about this.
Yeah.
They're going to spot this. Look how long this takes them. This is why I was so concerned. Like, you have Dire Side, but at the end of the day, it's still a gyrocopter.
Limp pops out. They're going to be able to find Soxa. That could be a free kill. The Elder Titan ultimate might be able to finish him off, but now a Meteor actually lands on both, bringing Chessie relatively low. They have Swindles getting off the ultimate. That's going to force a Resolution to pop his ult and TP out. DC, though, they've only lost a Winter Wyvern so far. Looks like Misery will be the second kill. Turns around, almost managing to finish up Limp there with the turnaround Breathe Fire, but still... little bit of damage on the tier 3. Fortunately for Complexity, the Necronomicon minions did die shortly after the tier 2 went down. Otherwise, that would have been potentially a whole entire tier 3 being taken while they were fighting around the Roshan pit. And speaking of which, they haven't even finished up Rosh yet. Still 4k and growing on his HP pool.
Yeah, they're going to go back in for it, and I think that's the play to make. But unfortunately, there's a Forge Spirit there, and I think it just takes them all the time in the world. Like, they don't have the ET ult anymore, they don't have Hanskin's ulti. It's a little bit concerning for me. And all the meanwhile, Mu is just going to split push this. You have to send somebody to deal with it. That's one of your Rosh heroes up at bottom. Z-Freak's going to get gone on. He goes down really quickly. That's almost a BKB now for the Slark too. We already talked about the difficulties of killing him. This just makes things even more difficult.
Yeah. No lockdowns to go through the magic immunity whatsoever. And Moo, he's going to draw someone up here to this top lane eventually. DC will get the space to push out bottom if they want to. Again, they're just stalling the Roshan pit at this point. Oh my god, what happened? All right, died next to the tier 2 tower, got sunstruck to death by Invoker.
I think Complexity's move is wrap around, try to kill, smoke kill a core.
Oh, they're actually going to try and take Roshan. They force somebody up top. They're going to try and take Roshan themselves with the Invoker, because Invoker is decently fast at doing it with Alacrity and his Forge Spirits. They may actually get this Aegis before Complexity is going to be here. Yep. It's down. DC. First Roshan kill of the game goes to their favor, and that was supposed to be the one objective that maybe Complexity could have, with some confidence, gone and five-manned and tried to push high ground with, see if they can end this game, or at least get themselves a big advantage in the next 5 minutes, but that's no longer the case.
This is a prime example of score just not mattering in a game. I know a lot of people in chat and stuff, they'll see that it's 10-9 and they'll criticize us talking about DC having this huge lead, but come on, you have to open up your eyes. Like, it's 7,500 XP, more than 6K net worth difference. They've got an Aegis now, and they have definitively the better late game too.
And they've got very clear opportunities as well. Complexity are going to be jumped on here by Resolution. Again, he's still got a BKB, so highly doubt they're going to be able to kill him. And if he does, well, they do get him. But are they going to be able to take him out a second time? He's going to BKB. He's going to turn. Fight. Starts going on a Chessie. The rest of his team is going to follow up. Moo's going to make it in through the back hole. Will be able to hit one. Z-Freak, actually, with Swindle's getting that decent ultimate, he hits a lot of the heroes of DC, and they may not be able to fight around that. It's still Moo as well as Resolution going in. They've managed to finish up Hanskin with the help of Soxa while Resolution gets Swindle's. They also control Limp now, holding him in place. They are all decently poisoned up, but Resolution doesn't give a damn. He's going to go in for this kill. Gets it two. Nobody of Digital Chaos ends up going down outside of their Aegis on Resolution, while all five of Complexity are dead.
Yeah, they're just gonna straight up push now. The game just becomes a matter of, can you defend the next two or three pushes? In terms of team fights, like, if you look at Complexity's lineup, that fight is some fight that they have to take, but they don't want to take, if that makes sense at all. Mm-hmm. Like, it's a free opportunity to get into a five-man and not allow DC to just immediately go for the high ground, because if anything, DC's going to wait for that second Aegis before they go for the high ground. But the limitations of their drafts are such that if you weren't pushing early, you were just going to get outfarmed and outsplit.
Yep. Update on our prediction. Splits, you're wrong once again.
On which one? Which
who
one?
Who do you think the magic damage was? 25 minutes.
By 25 minutes?
Yeah.
Dude, I thought it was 10 minutes.
No, I said 25 minutes, dude. Come on.
Last time it was 10, though.
Yeah, I know. These things change.
Oh, dang.
So, well, but who do you think it is now? I ain't telling you why you're wrong.
Is it the Slark?
No.
Is it Invoker?
No.
Is it Swindle's Lord?
It's the overfarmed Swindle's.
Oh, Swindle's.
With that jungle Venomancer and all the magic damage that comes from a nicely leveled Venno. With good ults.
I don't know why I doubted Swindles.
You really shouldn't have. And you're doubting him even still. Saying they're down and out.
I'm not saying they're down and out. I'm saying...
Oh, come on. They're pretty down and out. They just got wiped. It would take some, like, incredible timing for them to turn this game around, right? It would be like, win a big team fight, push in, take some control, maybe get some tier 2s or something, win another team fight, back up, Roche, go high ground, win another team fight. You're talking about an 8-minute narrative with the Slark and Invoker and Beastmaster only getting stronger and only split pushing you more. Limp almost gets popped there, will be saved by Hanskin. BKB popped out. Now the Winter's Curse actually coming into play, holding these heroes in place. Chessie, he's just getting kited around, right click down by the physical damage, doesn't get damn about PKB. Hanskin gets cleaned up. Swindle's also going to be hit by this one. Z-Freak hits a pretty good ultimate, but it doesn't seem to matter. It is going to be yet another wipe. Digital Chaos, they look healthy too. Even though they're ticking away with some of that Venomancer's poison damage, they are still, most of them, above half HP.
and this is Complexity have the superior team fight, but DC have such an overwhelming advantage in farm that it does you negate that advantage entirely. It's 20k XP, 15k net worth, going up to 20k at just 27 minutes into a game for a team that has the better late game.
Yeah,
that is pretty much a death sentence all around. And right now they're gonna get the first racks of the game. They don't even have pushing heroes. You talked about how Cole only had one high ground hero. Like, DC's not in a better position, but they can just more readily go for it. And Limp's gonna try to get some exit kills. This is a good plan, but unfortunately everyone is still all stuck together.
Yeah. Can't go for it with any confidence with his teammate so far behind. So he backs up 29, 28 minutes. Another 5.5 minutes until Roshan is up. DC, they want to take their time and wait for that to assure another high ground. They can go for it, as we've been talking about. They do have the better scaling. His resolution now picks up a basher for himself. Oh, come on, these Sunstrike kills. Jesus. Top lane, Z-Freak gets caught by Moo. Sunstruck down. Limp is going to try and get the turnaround kill. Him leading the way in the Shadowblade. Unfortunately, he is just 2 seconds too late. Moo blinks over to the side and TP's out.
I'm going to say in advance that people will think that I was biased in this cast, but I am much more biased to a draft.
Yeah.
Like, when a draft has such a clear and easy cut win condition, it's hard for me not to just say, oh, this team won. Yeah, they're going to call it for anything.
They don't even fight. They don't even lose a fight. I expected them to call it before.
I thought they were going to call it after the 15-9 fight.
Yeah.
Because they understand that this draft is just not going to work anymore. The timing has completely been thrown out, and there was almost no chance that Complexity were going to win this game. Like, when have you ever seen any lineup, especially one led by Swindles, just GG out like that? But that's how bad that game was.
Mm-hmm.
At even 10 minutes into the game, any mediocre caster could have just told you, like, oh, this game is going to be one-sided at the rate that this is going.
Well, it's a good thing I have one for you.
Hey.
First player to get 15 denies, the answer was none. And you were correct, though, about the smoke gang kills. That was two. So well
nice.
Done, Blitz Dota.
The deny ones, I was the closest. I checked. Invoker was the closest.
Yes,
to 15.
He was. He had 11 denies. All right, guys. A very rocky start for Complexity, who already had this nasty monkey on their back where they haven't been doing well against Digital Chaos. They lost to them in a series today, and now they have to play against them again, and it's going to be with a 1-0 lead for Digital Chaos. We're going to take a break and come back with game number 2 very shortly.